I guess, assumed the reins of the police department. And I don't know who spoke last week, but I know last time I had some big shoes to fill, because I think that was the week that Phil Paramore brought the choir in. And
too
I got
soon.
Here and I had some, I had a tall order. And I'm not going to sing for you, so you can thank the good Lord for that. It's been probably a little over a year and a half, like I said, since I was here. And when I was here, one of the things that I talked about was some of the things that we were going to try to accomplish at the police department. I have been with the police department for 33 years. So we've got some older gentlemen and ladies in here, but I understand Officer Cheshire, who's handling the audiovisual stuff, he probably wasn't even born. I don't think his parents were dating at that time, he said earlier. So law enforcement has come a long way. Certainly with some of the issues that law enforcement has had in the last several years has brought negative attention to law enforcement. Some of that, I think, is probably, is probably justified. I think that police departments can do a better job in the things that they do. And with that said, I'll bring your attention to the projector. And every operation and planning decision that we made is based on a strategic vision core of the way we operate our department. Okay, and at the very root of what we do is education and training, community policing and relations, strategic planning and performance management. So everything that we plan with our strategic vision all centers around this nexus. Briefly, the structure of our department, I know this is hard to see, but it's a typical paradigm of structure. Chief of police and the four that you have over the bureaus are captains. Before I was the chief of police, I was the police major. Okay, I haven't filled that position yet. That probably will happen at some point. I like to have time to evaluate the command staff I have, because what I want to do after 33 years with the Dothan Police Department, one day I will move on and probably retire. Hopefully that'll be a long time from now. But the captains are relatively new, and I say that by, I was a captain for 10 years, so they're relatively young and new, and it's very important to me when that time comes to leave this in the best hands that we possibly can. So each one of the captains have a bureau that they command. We have four bureaus. We have the patrol services, special operations, the administrative bureau, and the criminal investigations bureau. And with that, our structure breaks down in kind of a pyramid form. Our 2017 budget is about $20 million, $20.5 million, with about $2.4 million of that as an operating budget. Most of you who operate businesses and you have benefits and benefit packages, you understand that a large portion of what you do is salaries, fringes, things like that. So actual tires and gas and windshield wiper blades is significantly less. Take a moment to look at this. We're gonna hit just some basic stuff. I'm gonna run through some of this, but I think you'll find some of this stuff interesting because they mirror some of the goals that we have at the department. This is our sworn police officer by race. This chart shows 161 sworn. We actually have 172 positions. And the as you can see, first of all, you need to know that the city of Dothan is about 64% white, about 31% African American, and then the rest course, would be the other. And what I want to do is I want to, as closely as I can, mirror the demographics of the community with the sworn police force. We're not there yet, okay? So we're looking at about 30, we're looking at about a 30% number. We're right at 10%, okay? So we have to work toward that. As you can see, 82% of our department, or 134, are Caucasian male, while we only have about 10%, which is this 8%, and 2% is African American. So that's one of the things one of the goals that we have, and I'll get around to how we're going to go about doing that in just a few minutes. Accountability is one of the big words that many of the officers at the department hear from me day in and day out. Okay, and the reason, one of the driving forces behind that, is because we are an accredited law enforcement agency. Now, there are about 5 agencies in the state of Alabama that are accredited through the Commission of Accreditation of Law Enforcement Agencies. That's no different than if you sent your child to a college, you would want that college to be accredited, okay? In other words, they meet certain criteria and certain standards that set them apart from the other learning institutions. So when I talk about accreditation, it's very important. We are one of about 5% of the agencies in the entire United States, probably 18,000 police agencies. About 15,000 of those are state, local, and county that are nationally accredited through CLEA. You say, well, CLEA, okay, but what about others? There are some state accrediting agencies, but the gold standard of what you have to do is with the Commission of Accreditation Law Enforcement. And that's just a quick slide on what they do. They basically have a set of standards for the size of the department that you have, and if you do certain things, you have to do them certain ways. They don't tell you how you have to do it, but they say if you do this, you have to have a plan in place on how you do it. With that, of course, comes accountability, tracking, and things like that. So we have an internal affairs division, which is more commonly referred to, but we refer to it as a professional standards division. Okay, and we have internal processes for filing complaints, and by internal complaints, I mean if I have an officer that became involved in a vehicle pursuit and he didn't know why he was chasing the guy, and believe it or not, we'll have that every now and then. Why were you chasing him? Because he was running. Not a very good idea. Okay. So if I see that, I say, that ain't right, or one of the captains sees it, or a sergeant, or whomever, he says, we need to investigate this. So we actually file a large portion of the complaints that are lodged against the police department. The other, of course, is the external complaint. Citizens come into the department, they call us on the phone, they can write it on a napkin and send it to us, email us. We track everything that we get that is a complaint against the officer of the department. We make sure we document it and we track that. And here are, and I apologize, you can't read this very well, but here are the complaints that were tracked for last year, okay? And what you have is you have internal complaints. Again, these are the ones that we, as an agency, filed against ourselves, okay? You have 27 complaints. You got a total of 30. I'm sorry. Yes, 30 complaints. Let's look at this one right now. 30 complaints. 27 of those complaints were founded. In other words, the officer got involved in the pursuit, didn't have a reason to. We filed a complaint. That complaint was sustained. So 27 of those were sustained. One of them was unfounded. 2 of them are still open. And there were none not sustained and no exonerations. So 27 of the ones we file, we can say there's probably a policy violation there. Now on the external side, we had 25, and these numbers are fuzzy, but 18 of the 25 were unfounded, okay? Five of those are still open, one is exonerated, and we had one sustained complaint in 2016. Now, some of the things that we have to answer, well, what about the people who are afraid to complain, or they don't want to come to the police department to complain? That's one of the things that the Blueprint City thing, and I know Mr. Critt's part of that, some of you may be as well, but the Blueprint City is looking at some of that. How can we get people to complain? Well, I can't make someone complain against an officer if they're not wanting to do it. So we're looking at other ways that people can complain, perhaps online or something like that. Another thing that we track very strictly is, of course, our crime reporting. And there is a process involved in that. And these are the things that we do. Most of you have heard of the Uniform Crime Reporter, the UCR. You may or may not have it. This is kind of the central agency that tracks crime throughout the United States, of course, managed by the FBI, who is responsible for collecting, publishing, and archiving this stuff. And the Alabama Statistical Analysis Center, which is the Criminal Justice Information Center for the state, they break it down city by city within the state, and they report it to the UCR. So what do they report? They report different categories of crimes. Part one crimes includes your index crimes, as we call them. It's your homicides, your rapes, your robberies, and things like that. And then, of course, you have your part two crimes, which are your liquor offenses, your drug offenses, and so forth. And then, of course, they track things like law enforcement, officers killed in the line of duty, and things like that. Offenses by class for 2016. These are misdemeanors in the orange, and these are felonies. So of all the crimes that we had in the city of Dothan in 2016, 37% of those were felonies, while 55% of those reported were misdemeanors. 7% of those are violations. Okay, that can be getting a ticket because your dog's barking too loud or something like that. And then, of course, the 1% is not classified. That's the things that we track, such as a welfare check on someone, or something that's not really a crime, it's not a violation, and it's just kind of not classified. That number is usually very low. In 2016, here's a summary of the crime report we had reported in the city of Dothan. And I'll give you a moment to look at that. You see we had five homicides or murders in 2016. As is normal, theft and larceny is a large portion of the crimes that are committed. You can see aggravated assaults, arsons, ladies and gentlemen, auto burglaries, 466. 99% of those are people leaving their car unlocked. And somebody, and that's probably half the ones that we had. A lot of people say, somebody went and ran through my car, but I didn't call y'all. We still need you to call us. If you have someone who's going through your neighborhood, or you see somebody suspicious, or your car's been ransacked, we still need to know they did that. So if you have time to call us, please do, because it helps us establish maybe a time, a day, a motive, or a method of operation that they're using that'll help us maybe catch those people sooner. 115 robberies, sexual assaults was 44. Individual crime victims for 2016. We have this broken down too. Again, as part of our accreditation process, we track this stuff. Okay, we have it broken down into crime victims. So you have arson victims, white, black, female, male, sexual assault, same way. Anybody have any questions about any of this? If you do, please just ask as we move along. A lot of people like to know, well, how many robberies did y'all have this year?
How does that compare the numbers to other cities the same size as Dothan?
It's actually lower, yeah. You know, and of course, Decatur is probably about the the best comparison to Dothan. Actually, Tuscaloosa, if you discount the university, who really has their own police force and their own city limits, you have Tuscaloosa's about the same size.
I'm struck by the fact that the percentage that were apparently against black, the victims up there, is that right?
Yes. Oh, here it is, right here, broken down in a chart. You have violent crime victims by race, and other crimes victim by race. So your violent crimes, remember, murder, robbery, rape, theft is in there. But since you can't see this very well, 65% of the victims of violent crime in 2016 were African American.
What do you have the percent of perpetrators?
I don't have that on this. We track that as well, but I don't have that on this chart. I know that you have that's as Asian, Indian, and unknown, but 65, 34, violent crime. Other crime, 44 and 55. So we do this quarterly. Every quarter I furnish the city manager and the commissioners with a quarterly report of what you see here. And in the fourth quarter of 2016, one of the things that I noticed is if you were a black female, there was a 43% chance that you would be, 43% of the time, the victims were black females of violent crime. So that's kind of an astounding number if you really look at it, 43% of the victims.
Chief, when you say violent crimes, are you talking about domestic assaults or?
No, the violent crimes, again, are the index crimes. That's murder, rape, robbery, aggravated assault, and the UCR puts thefts in there as well.
But Chief, you know, I've looked at other areas in the past, and black-on-black crime rate has just astounded me. And you've got such a high percentage of these crimes against African-American people when they're a much lower percentage of the population. Yeah, and it's just astounding.
And you know, and that's why a lot of the officers, as John could tell you, would, you know, we spend a lot of time in those areas trying to prevent those crimes. And, you know, and as police chief, I have to answer the question, well, you're profiling, you're stop and frisk, you know, but, I mean, what do you want? You want a safe neighborhood, or you want the police to stop your uncle and say, you know, why, you know, where are you going at 2 a.m? You know, so that's one of the fun jobs I have, is trying to balance out that. There's a post going around on Facebook now by some guys getting shared all over the place, where they interviewed this guy for, said we beat him up and we did all this and all that. And I pulled a report this morning and read it, and criminal investigations is investigating this thing because he was propositioning young boys. And a third party called and complained it. We got there, and the kids said, yeah, I can't believe he did that. And we go to investigate it, end up putting him in jail. He tries to assault the officer, so they hit him with some pepper spray. And then a knucklehead that has an internet connection and a laptop, who calls himself media, videotapes an interview. And this guy's talking about how he just abused him and brutalized him and beat him. And we can't really say a whole lot about it because it's an ongoing investigation, and this guy's probably going to be arrested again. So it's just part of it, you know, comes with it. So, you know, but that's one of a very good point that you made is, you know, I think the New York Times, most of you know that I've been interviewed by some of the best over the last year. The New York Times spent 2.5 hours in my office, and one of the things that they said was, isn't it kind of, don't you find it a little odd that 58% of the tickets that are written to African Americans, and yet they represent 30% of the population? I said, yes, I do. Just like I find that, I find it hard to believe that, 58% of the victims of crime in Dothan are African American when they only represent 30% of the population. So it's not about black and white unless people try to make it that way. Successes. You have a flyer that's gone around. Please take it with you, look at it. This is an interesting thing that we've done, and since we got here, I think right at the outset, I started coming up with some ideas. How can we help support the police department and the community without having to go to the city commissioners or the city fathers to ask for money to do things? Examples, these cups, the umbrellas, things like that, all part of our positive approach toward policing and building trust in the community. Well, there may not be budget items for some of these things, so we need a way to do it. Once before, if Mr. Alan Clark gave us $10,000, we could have to put it in a rec fund, okay? And that rec fund, we could use it for was having a Christmas party for the police officer. Now people have an opportunity to donate to a nonprofit organization, which is separate from the police department, okay? It says Dothan Police Foundation. It is a standalone 501c3 with its own board of directors: Mark Saliba, Susan Anderson, Wayne Palmer, Stanley Davis, Chris Doss, Janaski Fleming's on it. They have their own, Bob Woodall, and Mark Dunning. They have, we meet about twice a year, and they can vote on the things that they do. I'm a de facto member of the board, but I'm a non-voting member because the bylaws have it set up where the acting or the current chief of police will be on the board to maintain the administrative stuff, do the scheduling and things like that. But there are three areas, and these are clearly defined in the brochure that you have, that this money can be used for, and nothing more. Okay, law enforcement, education, and training. Of course, education is listed first for a reason. We think that having smarter police officers is probably is equally important as having well-trained police officers. The second one is the Community First Initiative. I'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. And the Pro-Life Animal Services Program. Dothan boasts last year we had an 11% euthanasia rate in dogs. That's remarkable for a government-operated shelter. It really is. But the foundation is committed, let's get that number even lower, by being able to fund transport services, to give money to spay and neuter clinic if we need to get some of these animals taken care of. And again, it's the ideology of the community investing in itself. So I'm real proud of that. I guess you can tell from that. It started on mid-August, so it's just now taken root. There's a website you can go to and a PayPal account if you wanted to donate. But just pass the word that we're doing that. I know the Dothan Eagle called me yesterday, and they're interested in doing an article on it. The Southeast Alabama Regional Police Alliance. We are working in conjunction, and have been, with the Command and Staff College of Auburn University of Montgomery in educating police officers in our region. Now, Headland or Abbeville or Slocum, they can't really afford to send their police officers to these expensive training sessions. So what we want to do is we want to host those accredited hours at the police department, and we want to offer that to them at no cost if possible, and bring in FBI instructors. We have some academic stuff we're going on, because our philosophy is to make the entire law enforcement region more educated and better trained. COPS grant. We filed for a COPS grant and was awarded $202,000 for the purchase of body-worn cameras. John is here. He is one of the 14 that we have deployed in a trial phase right now. And if you look at John, you see he looks like a big guy. He's got about 20 extra pounds of bulletproof vest and body camera on him. Okay, and John, will it activate if you jump up and down?
I don't have a set right now.
You don't have a set, okay.
When he goes out in the field, if he
gets knocked down, it'll come on. If he says camera on, it'll come on. If he starts running, it'll come on. And this is a very, very expensive system. And you say, well, you had 30 internal complaints last year. You had 25 external complaints last year. One of those was founded. Is it cost effective? Is it necessary? You know, certain things you have to do for peace of mind and building trust in the community, and I think that's what this is. But the system that we're looking at, and we're getting ready to go before the commission and ask for some funding for it, will fund a system, if not this one, one very similar to it, because it's important for me to have a fail-safe system. You know, about a year ago, you saw an incident that occurred in Montgomery, and they said, well, the camera didn't come on. What's the first thing people think? They've erased it. They didn't turn it on. They erased it. So that's one of the things that you're probably going to see a headline on in the next month or so. It's going to be pursuing the body-worn camera.
Will these cameras transmit